war will ever end. There's fighting that will break us up again.
Welcome back to our special news coverage, the war in Vietnam. Due to the requirements of the war efforts and the production of necessary munitions for the war effort, the manufacturing industry has suffered steep declivity. Factories that would have once been producing civilian goods are now being used to produce weapons of war, which has caused many to criticize the government's handling of economic policy. Now let's go live to our foreign correspondent, Branderson Neuber, who is with the 31st Battalion in Vietnam. Branderson, take it away.
Thanks, Walter. I'm here in Saigon, Vietnam, with American forces as they're preparing vigorously in the case of a Vietnamese attack. Here to talk about the military advances and technologies of the war is Lieutenant Jordan.
How are you, Grant Branderson? It's been a while.
Yeah. Never met you.
Yeah, so my personal favorite is the old M60 machine gun. It's got the brute force of a Browning 30 cal, but its recent upgrades make it compact and easy to carry. Over here you got your M16 standard issue for all you novice grunts.
The M16 is the primary weapon used by U.S. forces on the ground. This is the first war the M16 has been used by the U.S. military, and as the war has progressed, flaws have been evident in the weapon, including jamming, which has resulted in the preference of the M14 by some troops. Major Wasserman carries the Smith & Wesson Model 15 revolver with a 6-inch barrel. Primarily carried by high-ranking officers, this weapon is ideal for self-defense in close-quarters combat. It has a 6-round cylinder and shoots 38mm rounds at about 1,100 feet per second. He also carries the Mark II, or the pineapple grenade, and it gets its name from the grooved cast iron shell that is believed to aid in the fragmentation of the grenade. The M2A17 portable flamethrower was used by Zippo squads who carried out search and destroy missions in the jungles of Vietnam.
Oh,
what's that?
Let me ask you something.
Who the f*** do you think you are? Huh?
Good game, bro.
Back to you.
Well, folks, it looks like there might be some minor technical difficulties over in Saigon. We're going to switch to our local correspondent, Jeff, you betcha. To get the scoop on how Americans are reacting to the war. Jeff?
Thanks, Walter. It's Jeff Ubecha here in the Pacific Palisades, where I got the opportunity to talk to several people regarding the war in Vietnam. I got the chance to talk to Jack Scharf regarding the war in Vietnam and his experience in America's college campus.
Me and my friends at Duke have been starting some riots protesting the war. We're thinking about maybe going after the ROTC building next. It's kind of inspired by some of my friends over at Berkeley. They started doing it first. It's really been different on campus because a lot of my friends were drafted.
I also got the chance to talk to hippie Denton Van Duzer.
I just don't get why everyone has to hate everyone. Like, just get along, be happy, everyone loves everyone, man, and just the free love, and just, it's a conspiracy or something, and just, all these kids just need to learn how to stop fighting and not fight and just be happy, man, and just get along, and just, everyone, just get along.
Oftentimes, politicians really don't see the personal side of conscription. This was evident in my interview with Isaac Margulies, where he talked of the more personal aspects of the draft.
Yeah, so I got drafted a couple months ago, and I ship out sometime
next couple weeks. I just think this sucks that I have to go fight a war, put my life on the line when it has nothing to do with my own choice. I don't even think we should be in the war. It's like my country's deciding how much my life is worth.
Oh, didn't see you there. Back to you, Walter.
That's some damn good reporting, Jeff. Damn good. On the domestic front, the Joint Economic Committee of Congress reports that the war has created havoc in U.S. financial markets, and that the spending in Vietnam has debilitated President Johnson's Great Society fiscal programs. It appears that all of our technical difficulties have cleared up, and we can return with our live coverage of the war in Vietnam with Branderson Newberg. Take it away, Branderson.
Vietnam has been a highly controversial issue among the American public for the past 18 years due to the unjustified occupation of the country. The question on everyone's mind is, why are we putting the lives of American soldiers at risk to stomp out communism in Indochina?
So right now I've got to fill this 51-second segment of the video with a bunch of political mumbo-jumbo on the war, because this is a school project that needs to be educational, and voiceovers are really the easiest place to get all that information in. So, politics. Under Johnson, the U.S. has seen the development of direct involvement on the ground in Vietnam. After the passing of the Gulf of Tonkin Resolution, Americans have also witnessed a drastic change in the increase of number of troops from approximately 23,000 in 1964 to roughly 550,000 in 1968. President Johnson's manipulation of this bill has proved to be extremely unproductive and detrimental to his term in office. Is that good enough for you, Mr. King? Because now we can get back to the cool stuff. No offense.
I'm in the cab of a UH-1 chopper, also known as the Huey. This aircraft has proved to be a vital asset to the troops on the ground, as it provides munitions, troops, and intelligence on approaching forces. This specific gunner has been equipped with an M60 light machine gun, which can provide 600 rounds per minute of cover fire at up to 900 meters.
Riveting stuff. Truly riveting. All right, at this point in the segment, we're going to take a break to talk to the White House press secretary, George Christian. Welcome to the program, George.
Good to be back, Walter.
I don't think you've been on, but, you know, that's all right. So, George, tell me, how is the current status of the war affecting President Johnson's approval ratings?
Well, Walter, after the 1966 midterm congressional elections, his bid for re-election in the 1968 presidential election collapsed as a result of turmoil in the Democratic Party related to opposition to the Vietnam War.
Very interesting. Well, thanks for joining us, and I look forward to seeing you next time.
Always a pleasure, Walter.
Once again, you've never been on the show before. Okay, let's return to our exciting on-the-ground coverage of the war in Vietnam. Take it away, Branderson.
Thanks, Walter. And even as North and South Vietnam agreed on a ceasefire, American troops remain on this volatile border. I am deeply embedded within one of the infantries as they remain vigilant for any Charlie activity. However, as today is the first day of the Lunar New Year in the Vietnamese calendar, we are not expecting much action.
Lieutenant, watch your two!
Hey, what's their position? Hey, get a grenade out there! I'm hit! Back, pull back! Pull back! I'm hit!
Must be some kind of way out of here. Say the Joker to the thief. there's too much confusion. I can't get no relief. Businessman there, drink my wine. Plowman, dear.